Hello, my name is Professor Klebert. I'm a urologist. I'm the head of the Interventional Ultrasound Center at the University of Munich. And today I would like to speak about the use of contrast-enhanced ultrasound in diseases of the carotid artery. So the major question is, did we really need contrast-enhanced ultrasound in the examination of the carotid artery? So if we compare, for example, MRI or CTA, we see with one-stop shopping the complete extent of the carotid artery. We see probably the high degree of the ICA stenosis on the left side, and even we see the complete minimal lumen of this stenosis. If we compare that to the MRI, we see the vertebral artery stenosis, we see the stenosis of the subclavian artery, and even we see the high degree stenosis of the ICA on the left side. So the question is there really a need? Stroke is the third leading cause of death after ischemic heart diseases and cancer. We know that atherosclerotic diseases may affect the intracranial vessels themselves. 88% of patients with amaurosis fugus or hemisplenic trans-ischemic attack have atherosclerotic diseases of the carotid artery, especially in the bifurcation area. Approximately 25 to 50% of all strokes are caused by an unstable carotid plug, and about 80% of all strokes are ischemic. Pathologies of the carotid artery are an interdisciplinary challenge. Therefore, a reliable ultrasound examination is essential. In unclear cases, an advanced diagnostic imaging is necessary, especially to find a solution whether stenting, surgery, or neurotherapy will be the best for our patient. Therefore, we need a new diagnostic challenge. From my opinion, the new diagnostic challenge will be contrast-enhanced ultrasound. If we use contrast-enhanced ultrasound, we need a special amount of contrast agent. Depending on the system we are using, the amount of contrast is between 1.6 to 2.4 cc of contrast, followed by 10 cc of saline flash. Generally, every baseline examination should start with a grayscale examination. In this example, we see the carotid bulb, we see the common carotid artery, the external carotid artery, and the internal carotid artery. At the grayscale, we don't see major pathologies. If we now go to the Karl Doppler settings, we see nice flow in the common carotid artery, external carotid artery with one branch here, and the internal carotid artery. And if I ask my colleagues, did you see any stenosis, they will say, okay, it's not the perfect vessel, but we don't see major stenosis. So maybe we could change our mind if we now inject a little bit of contrast agent. So if we inject contrast agent, we see the nice filling of the common carotid artery, the external carotid artery, the internal carotid artery. And if we look at this point here, probably none of us have seen the stenosis of the internal carotid artery. We see that the technique has no overriding artifacts in comparison to the Karl Doppler, and we see that only the lumen of the vessel is filled with contrast. Generally, we can have to make a decision whether we would like to have the examination with some background information, either colored in purple or in gray, or whether we would like to have the examination just in the pure contrast mode. I personally prefer the background information, so I get some background information about the anatomic structures. Atherosclerotic stenosis of the proximal part of the internal carotid artery are a major cause of stroke, and approximately 10 to 50% of all ischemic strokes occur in the territory of the internal carotid artery. Before surgical treatment, it's important to to make a clear diagnosis whether it's a preoclusive stenosis, that means a stenosis at least more than 90% of the internal carotid artery, or whether the patient suffers from a complete occlusion of the internal carotid artery. If there will be a complete occlusion of the internal carotid artery, no treatment is necessary. Regarding the stenosis, we start with a baseline examination in grayscale. We see on the left side pretty good the plaque on the dorsal wall and also on the ventral wall of the internal carotid artery. We see the minimum lumen of this flow. And here's also a technique where we could see the minimum extent of the stenosis and the complete length of the stenosis in comparison to the normal diameter of the vessel. By using the color Doppler or power Doppler mode, we see some aliasing here. That means we have got a very, very high velocity in this area in comparison to the normal velocity in the common carotid artery. It is essential to measure the maximum velocity. And if we look in our special case here, in the stenosis, we have got an intrastenotic velocity with a velocity over 450 centimeters a second. This means it's a very high degree of ICA stenosis, and this patient needs to be treated either by standing or open surgery. Will be there any additional information now if we inject, in this case, additional contrastant ultrasound? You can build your own mind, and I repeat just the examination by doing this. So we inject contrast, we see a nice filling of the common carotid artery, we see the complete extent of the stenosis, we see the poststenotic area and the presenotic area, and even we could see the contrast uptake of the plaque, which is not visible by color Doppler or power Doppler. After a couple of seconds, we see even that the contrast arrived in the stenosis and later also appear here in the jugular vein, just the way back to the heart. If we now magnify the image and repeat it just, we see the complete extent of the jugular vein, we see the complete extent of the internal carotid artery stenosis without artifact. We could detect slow and fast flow at once without overriding artifacts. And if we magnify the image, we see some bubbles inside, just as a sign that we have got some vasovasorum in this kind of plaque. In this case, this patient already undergo a CT examination, and in the CT report, they said, it seems to be that this patient has got a complete occlusion of the ICA. Unfortunately, this patient developed several small strokes. Therefore, we had to have to find out whether there's still a minimum flow in the internal carotid artery or it will be a complete occlusion. If we look at the grayscale, we could not see a major flow here in the internal carotid artery. There's a flow in the common carotid artery. So now I just skip to the color Doppler settings. Therefore, we see the nice filling of the common carotid artery. And the question is, are these red dots here some artifacts, or is this a real flow inside? This means, is this now a pseudo-occlusion or a complete occlusion, which have got a major effect on the treatment of this patient? In the next step, we just inject a little bit contrast. The first result we have seen is the external carotid artery, the common carotid artery, and here we see the complete extent of the pseudo-occlusion of the internal carotid artery, and the question how long is this pseudo-occlusion is also very easy to answer. We just go to the next slide and we see the complete extent of this pseudo-occlusion. This is the reason why the patient developed a couple of strokes in the past, and this patient have to have a treatment in this disease. Also in this patient, there was a question whether this patient suffered from a complete occlusion of the ICA or not. In grayscale, it seems to be some hypercalcemic organic plugs inside in this vessel. By using the CalDoppler mode, we see just the first branch of the extracorporeal artery, but we could not detect, even we have got a good velocity, any flow in the internal carotid artery in this patient. Now maybe power Doppler is more sensitive, as we know in the past, has more luck to detect any flow in the internal carotid artery. But even in this case, we could not see any flow inside here, so there seems to be a suspicion of occlusion of the internal carotid artery. Additionally, we inject contrast, we see the complete filling of the common carotid artery, we see the external carotid artery, the first branch here, but we see only here a minimum lumen of the internal carotid artery, but after this minimum lumen, the complete internal carotid artery is occluded. So this means this patient needed not to be treated either by standing or open surgery. Patients who undergo a treatment either standing or carotid endarterectomy have to have a follow-up examination. So traditional carotid endarterectomy has to be the procedure of choice for symptomatic or asymptomatic patients. Nowadays, even there's an option that patient could go under carotid artery stenting, especially if a patient is a high-risk patient because the patient has got neck radiation or high or low cervical lesion or have some problems with the cardiopulmonary diseases, then there will be an option to undergo stenting of the carotid artery. But both methods have some risks, that there will be restenosis either on endarterectomy or stenting of the carotid artery. This patient is a follow-up examination after carotid endarterectomy. We see in the grayscale the bulb, we see the patch plastic here just adjacent to the bulb. And the question is whether the patient suffers still from a restenosis or if everything is right. It seems to be very difficult in grayscale to answer this question, therefore we just change the setting and look at the CalDoppler and power Doppler settings. This is the bulb, that's the external carotid artery, internal carotid artery, common carotid artery. It seems to be some soft plugs just adjacent to the carotid wall. Maybe power Doppler is a little bit more helpful, but even here we have some problems that we could not detect the complete flow volume in the internal carotid artery. Again, we inject a little bit contrast to see what about this vessel. So take a couple of seconds, then we see the common carotid artery, the external carotid artery, the internal carotid artery, and if we compare this just to the CalDoppler and power Doppler setting, we have got a nice fitting of the complete bulb, and we can say the patient has some soft plugs here, but the patient doesn't suffer from any stenosis of the internal carotid artery in this case. After open surgery, the patient even could develop hematoma. This patient has got a hematoma just adjacent to the common carotid artery because he undergo open surgery of the carotid artery. And the question is it still now an active bleeding or not? So we have to find out whether the patient needs to have a treatment or not. If we look at this axial plane, we see pretty good the complete extent of the hematoma. The hematoma already compressed a little bit the jugular vein. By using the power Doppler setting, we see the flow in the common carotid artery, but we couldn't detect any flow in this hematoma. Does it mean that there is no active bleeding if we couldn't detect any flow by power Doppler in this hematoma? Probably we have to rule out this and inject in a little bit contrast agent. So it takes some seconds when the contrast arrived. Here is a nice thing of the common carotid artery. Here we see the hematoma. The hematoma still appear in black, so it doesn't show any contrast uptake. So it seems to be that there is no active bleeding. Here we see the jugular vein. And of course, we have got an examination time up to 3 minutes. After a single injection of contrast, we take our time and just change the view and look a little bit later, that after 1 minute, we see the hematoma is still black, so no active bleeding. After 1.5 minutes, no change, no active bleeding. So this patient have to have no treatment because we didn't see any active bleeding after correct surgery. Patients who undergo stenting of the internal carotid artery even have some problems because they have to have a follow-up for the end of their life. In grayscale, we see very nice the stent placed in the internal carotid artery. But the question is there any in-stent stenosis? Probably it's very difficult to answer this question by fundamental grayscale examination. So we just use the power Doppler and color Doppler setting. So we see a nice filling of the stent in these both modes. It seems to be no major stenosis, but of course we have to measure the maximum velocity in stent to detect any stenosis. If we look at the maximum velocity in the stent, we have got a velocity between 2 meters or 2.5 meters. This seems to be not a normal velocity. Therefore, there's a suspicion of an in-stent stenosis. But by using the color Doppler or power Doppler settings, we couldn't detect any in-stent stenosis. Again, we inject a little bit contrast. We see we have the same plane. And now we see pretty fine that in this part of the stent, there is no contrast uptake. Seems to be an in-stent stenosis. And if we just shift the probe in an axial plane and repeat the examination, we see that half of the lumen doesn't show any contrast uptake. And if we magnify the image and just scan it again, we see again the complete extent of the stenosis. And in this case, we see pretty fine that about 50% of the stent has got a stenosis inside, called an in-stent stenosis, without any contrast uptake. And if we compare this now to color Doppler or power Doppler, it's much easier to detect these in-stent stenosis without the overriding artifacts in this other technique. Dissection of the cervical segment of the carotid artery or vertebral artery are very uncommon. The incidence is about 1 to 3 cases or 100,000 cases. 15 to 20% of all cerebral infarction in young adults are causes to dissection of these vessels. Cervical dissection are usually classified as either traumatic or spontaneously. Therefore, we have to answer whether there's still a blood flow in the fourth and in the true lumen, and what about the risk of thrombosis. Starting again with a grayscale examination, it seems to be here a flap just adjacent to the common carotid artery wall. But the question is it now just a flap or is it maybe a collapsed false lumen? Again, we shift to the color Doppler and power Doppler settings. And it seems to be a little bit flow here. And also it seems to be just a flap in the middle of the vessel. The question is this now an artifact or is it really a dissection? Again, we have to inject a little bit contrast and repeat the examination. Then we see pretty fine that there is a flap just in the middle of the vessel. And again, also here is a small lumen of the dissection. And if you just shift now the probe in the axial plane, we see pretty good the complete extent of the dissection, the true lumen, the false lumen, and the flap which enters the middle of this vessel. Also, I would like to show you some rare cases like fistula of the jugular vein and the internal carotid artery, aneurysm, and also I would like to speak about carotid body tumors. This old woman was lying on the intensive care unit. They tried to place a central line catheter in the jugular vein. Unfortunately, the patient developed some problem with the heart afterwards. So there was a suspicion of a fistula between the jugular vein and the common carotid artery. If we look very carefully at the grayscale, there seems to be a connection between the jugular vein and the carotid artery just in this area here. And if you now go to the color Doppler setting, we see a lot of aliasing as an indirect sign of a fistula just between the common carotid artery and the jugular vein. If we now inject a little bit contrast, we see the complete extent of the fistula canal without artifacts, without overriding artifacts. And we also see the angle of the central line, which was not perfect in this case. This patient also undergo central line placement. Afterwards, there was a suspicion of a hematoma. So there is just a hematoma just between the jugular vein here and the concoid artery. If we look in the calibre setting, it seems to be that there seems to be some flow in this hematoma. So is this now a pseudoaneurysm or just a hematoma or is this a fistula between the two vessels? So if we inject a little bit contrast, we see pretty nice the filling of the concoid artery, and we see that these hematomas show up contrast uptake as an indirect sign of the pseudoaneurysm after intervention. And we see the complete extent of the pseudoaneurysm here. There is not a direct connection to the jugular vein. If we have the same examination just in the longitudinal plane, we see here is the neck of the pseudoaneurysm and here is the pseudoaneurysm, which shows the uptake of the bubbles in this area. The axial plane, again, there's a pseudoaneurysm, which compress also a little bit the jugular vein. And of course, these pseudoaneurysms have to be treated afterwards. Aneurysms of the external internal carotid artery are rare. So if we look at this case, there seems to be an aneurysm of the inner carotid artery. This is the concoid artery, this is the external carotid artery. Of course, this aneurysm has to be treated. This aneurysm has got a diameter about 2 centimeters. The question from the surgeon is, are there thrombotic changes in the aneurysm? And what about the complete extent of this aneurysm? So if we try to answer the question, we see the same examination in the calibroplasty setting and even in the podoplasty setting. There seems to be some thrombotic changes in this area or here. And now I would like to repeat the examination just by using contrast ultrasound. We see the complete extent of this aneurysm. And if we skip the probe in the axial plane, we see these huge thrombotic changes in the aneurysm. And we can say this aneurysm had at least a diameter of about 2 centimeters in this direction and 2.5 centimeters in this direction. This young man was sent to us because from his house doctor there was a suspicion of an aneurysm of the common carotid artery. So if we start the examination in the grayscale, there seems to be an hypogenic mass just adjacent to the common carotid artery, either the thrombotic mass or something else. If we now use the calibroplasty setting, we could see very fast there seems to be some vessels in this mass here just adjacent to the common carotid artery. Often we find carotid body tumors just in the bifurcation of the carotid artery or just adjacent to the common carotid artery. So it seems to be a body tumor of the carotid artery in this case. If it will be a carotid body tumor, this tumor will have a very, very fast and very strong contrast uptake, very similar like the common carotid artery, so repeat the examination. There's the common carotid artery and see this tumor has the same contrast uptake as seen here in this vessel, and we see pretty fine the complete extent of this common body tumor, which have to be treated afterwards, just the bifurcation, and you see part of this tumor also entered already the bifurcation of the carotid artery as is seen it here in the middle of the image. There's the bifurcation. My last topic will be characterization of plaques. The most widely accepted predictor for stroke is the degree of carotid stenosis. However, other additional imaging features become recognized as significant factors. Plaque ulceration has been long thought to play a major role in the etiology of strokes of the internal carotid artery diseases. There was already done a couple of studies by MRI CTA which detected plaques and tried to quantify these plaques. but due to the advantage with a very high temporal resolution and spatial resolution, we can also use the contrast and ultrasound examination to look for neovascularization of plaques. If we start again with a grayscale examination and polyp examination, we see the complete extended plaque here on the conchoid artery. By using the powder examination, we could not see major flow inside. So the question is, does this plaque show any contrast uptake, yes or no? So we inject contrast, we see the contrast uptake in the conchoid artery, and this plaque is complete plaque, so it seems to be no contrast uptake. And even if we look in the later phase after 2 minutes, there seems to be no contrast uptake. This means not every plaque has to have contrast uptake, even if it's a huge soft plaque. This is the next patient, also with some soft plaques, either on the dorsal wall of the conchoid artery, but also on the ventral part of the conchoid artery. Again, we look for the vascularization in the Karl Doppler or Power Doppler mode. Both techniques could not show any flow inside of these plaques. And the question is whether we have more success now with this patient to see whether the plaque shows any contrast uptake. Again, we inject contrast, we see the complete extent. Here seems to be also stenosis. And if we look very carefully, we see a couple of bubbles appear here in this area. And over time, we see more and more bubbles appear here, but also in this area, a couple of bubbles appear. Sometimes it's very difficult to see the complete extent of the bubble uptake. Therefore, I recommend just to store this image and look again at the summary of the image. So if we start, we see it's complete plaque, and over time, there the bubble appear, here bubbles appear. So the contrast uptake over time on the ventral part, and even a little bit later, also on the dorsal part of the common carotid artery. If we look at the conchoid artery in this patient, it seems to be a very complex situation. It seems to be that this patient has got some ulceration here. The question is this a real ulceration or a high degree of stenosis? Probably we have to rule out to use contrast and ultrasound in this setting. So we inject a little bit of contrast. Seems to be here in the middle a high degree of stenosis, and even here this patient has some ulceration there and there. If we just look again, there's ulceration and there's ulceration, and if we now skip the probe in a different longitudinal plane, we see complete ulceration here, there's ulceration, and here, and even here this patient suffers from a high degree of a common carotid artery stenosis. If we just look at the pure contrast mode, we get similar results. The complete extent of the ICA stenosis and the bulbous ulcus here on the ventral part and even on the dorsal part of the common carotid artery. My final case will be this patient, which suffers from a high degree of stenosis. We see the lysing here. The question is, does this plaque already show some contrast uptake, yes or not? By using the Karl Doppler, we could not see any flow inside. It's a kind of mixed plaque. Here seems to be some calcification, and here seems to be some soft plaques. Again, we repeat the examination. So we see complete extent of the stenosis here. And of course, we see here a couple of bubbles appear, either from the vessel, and also a couple of bubbles appear, which was feeding from the wall of the common carotid artery. So in the guidelines from the EFSM, which was just published in 2011, there are some indications for the use of contrast and ultrasound in disease of the carotid artery. For example, if the patient suffers from a stenosis, which is very difficult to see, then the use of contrast and ultrasound could improve it. Patient after standing have some problems sometimes to see the complete extent of the lumen. Even in this case, the use of contrast and ultrasound will be a helpful tool to see whether the patient suffers from an instant stenosis. If the patient has got a dissection, sometimes it's difficult to say whether the false lumen show any flow anymore. And even here in this case, If we inject contrast, we could make a clear diagnosis. If there are complications after vascular interventions, either fistula or huge hematomas, the use of contrast and ultrasound could be very helpful for the planning of the follow-up of this patient, whether the patient needs to have a treatment, for example, if it's an active bleeding or if it's a fistula. And finally, we also could see that a couple of plaques show contrast uptake. And in previous study, we have to find out whether there will be a close correlation between the risk of strokes and the plaque contrast uptake. Just one comparison between the cardioblast settings and the contrast ultrasounding settings, which would be the advantage. So we just start with the first topic, ELISA. Sometimes if we have got a high degree of stenosis, there seems to be sometimes ELISA. If we compare this to contrast ultrasound, there's no ELISA. The single dropout, if the scanning angle is not perfect by cardioblast, in contrast ultrasound, it's independent. We have got a very high spatial resolution and contrast ultrasound. There's a low spatial resolution by using the cardioblast settings. By using the contrast setting, we could detect slow and fast flow at once. By using the cardioblast, we have to make the decision whether we focus on high flow or slow flow for the complete extent of the stenosis. There will be no blooming artifact in comparison to blooming artifact by cardioblast. It's difficult to see the flow direction sometimes by using contrast. Of course, there will be some advantage by using the cardioblast settings. If you just look how much parameter we have to change, sometimes by using contrast, we just have to push one button and we can start. In cardioblast, it seems to be somewhat difficult. And also, we have no limitation with the wall filter like we have in the cardioblast settings in comparison to the contrast-enhanced settings. So I hope you have learned a lot of new topics, and thanks for your attention.